think we really need to be aware of that and conscious of that. As I shared earlier, sometimes we tend to label. There's no labeling in a trauma-informed model. And I had a elementary school, and one of the office staff was just really frustrated. And when I had stopped by, she wanted to talk to me, and she said, she was upset with the principal. Said, we have a boy, his mom drops him off every day, he gets out of the car and he throws himself on the ground and he refuses to get up. And doggone it, he's done this for over a week. I don't know why we don't just pick him up and bring him into school. And I said, wow. Gets out of the car and throws himself down. I wonder what's going on. What kind of trauma is in this little guy's life? Oh, no, Jim. I've known him for years. He goes, Jim, that's not trauma. He didn't have trauma. He's manipulative. And I said, how do you make that determination? She says, because when I ask him to get up, he looks at me and he smirks. Mm. Well, when the mom drops this little guy off, she gets out of the car because he throws himself on the ground, and then she screams at him that she's going to call the police and have him arrested if he doesn't go to school. So there's motivation to stay on the ground. And motivation for the staff to get her out of there because she's causing a lot of the problems. But what I found out about this young man's history, dad gets out of prison. Mom takes this little boy over to dad and said, he's yours. I don't want him. So dad hadn't had much of a relationship because of his incarceration. So dad's trying to raise his kid. And dad gets pulled over for a traffic violation and he's in possession of drugs and he knows that that's going to be a probation violation. And that he will be sent back to prison on that. So he commits suicide. So where does this little boy go? He goes back to the mom who rejected him, didn't want him. And that's not manipulation, that's trauma. You know, when we look at I'm going to go through this fairly quickly, but when we look at our traditional discipline, it's really built on fear and control. I know it well because I used it. So if a student would come into my office, I was at the middle school for 22 years, so it took me 22 years before I was able to graduate to get to the high school. So at the middle school, I'm there for 22 years, and if a student came in and started raising his voice with me, I would raise mine higher. He wanted to take it up, I went up higher. So I had control. And then I'd bring it all the way down, and I would say, this is how I would like to communicate. I thought it was a great strategy. Fear-based. I control it. So when we use fear-based, I'm a minister's kid, so I always say that that was either three aces on my parents or three aces on me. But yeah, where Dr. Macy was sharing, spare the rod, spoil the child. Unfortunately, I grew up in that era where it was taken literally. So I got the belt a lot. And I never felt like my parents spanked me that I didn't deserve it. So when they spanked me, I felt that I was bad and I deserved that spanking. So I made a commitment. Because of that fear is that I would not spank my own children. So we started having our family. I had found a hack paddle in my classroom when I was teaching at the time. You know, the ones with all the holes. I've heard the holes are so it can get down and hit you good. I think they put it down there so that you hear the whistle as it's coming. Because I had a couple of hacks in my time. But I took that hack paddle home. And I'm raising three girls. And they were small. And I wasn't going to spank them. So what did I do? I would bring them in when we needed the discipline. And I would hold up the paddle. Do you want one hard swap of the paddle or grounding? Grounding. Okay. Did that for a year and a half or so. And then my middle daughter walks in one day, right? Go through the routine and she says, I'll take the hat. So what? She says, I'll take the SWAT, Dad. I said, well, I'm giving some time. I said, well, you go on out and think about it. It's really gonna hurt. And I'm freaking out. I'm not gonna hit her with this stupid thing. She's supposed to choose grounding like they always do. So she comes back and her little stretch pants had every magazine we had in the house stuffed in the back. And we dropped the paddle and had a good laugh. But manipulation through fear, that's what it was. And yet, I didn't want my kids to fear the bell whipping and what have you. But what did I do? I'm using fear as a way of controlling which way I wanted them to go. So I mean, you have your stories, I'm sure. But the fear-based model is just not working. And for so many of our kids that are coming from trauma, they're already in fear. And when we use fear-based tactics with them, they are going to escalate because they fear that they're in danger. Now we can say, I run the most managed class. I believe it. But it's not about you. It's about the kid and their perception and what they're seeing. Sometimes they're supposed to conform to us. We need to go to them and go one step further to see what's driving the behavior. I think in education today, one of the biggest challenges that we have is we've got dysregulated adults working with dysregulated children. It's not a good match. Both escalate. And usually the kid's going to lose in the long run because their behavior is going to go so far off the charts that they're going to end up sending them home. That's not a, please, when I share it with you, I'm not labeling anybody because this is part of my learning and part of my practice was to learn that I had to stay regulated if I wanted to make a difference. So when we look at that, I'm going to teach you some tools and some systems on how to put a trauma-informed model in place. And hopefully you can take some of that with you. But as an adult, we have to recognize when our trigger has been hit. And you're all normal. You're all good people. And you all have triggers. There's certain triggers that really set us off. For me, if you told me no, if I asked you to do something, and the student said no, that was a trigger. Yelling at me was trigger. So I had these little triggers of my own that would trigger me into escalating, getting control, thinking I was doing the right thing. But with the trauma approach, we've got to be aware when our trigger starts to go off. And we all know where it starts. Mine starts right here. And I would tell my kids, this is where my trigger starts. And if I don't catch it here, it's going up. Where's your trigger? And with the high school kids, they were able to tell me where they felt it. So teaching about those triggers, and since you're normal, and since we all have triggers, and since a kid has set one of our triggers, the reason we don't go off is because if we go off, we lose the opportunity to make a difference with that student. We lose the opportunity to create a relationship of trust. We lose the opportunity to be a caring adult in that student's life. And we lose the opportunity to create a sense of safety. So if I'm triggered, I need to catch it. And it's okay. Like I said, it's normal. It's hard to keep it there. Especially for some of us, the F-offs, it's hard to keep it there. But what we do when our triggers go off is we follow this pattern. We recognize what has happened, we react. That pushes that kid's button because now we're dysregulated. That causes them to escalate further. In that continuum that I showed you in the last presentation, I showed you that a child's negative belief. One is they feel they're stupid. They call themselves stupid. So if we have 70,000 self-thoughts a day, and I'm calling myself stupid constantly, that's the reason for many of these kids' behaviors when you take this step forward. We went to four separate elementary schools. We happened to be there when the same call came in to come down and get Johnny out of my class. He's under the table, he's screaming and yelling, he's using bad words, I can't teach, I want him out. And when those kids were brought down, they were highly escalated. When we took him into a quiet place, and Brooke, not me, Brooke started talking to them and asking them about themselves. And at first, I don't want to talk. She stayed calm. And she would say, you're okay. You're safe. You're going to be safe. And finally, these are little guys. They can't. The de-escalation. And then she'd have them do something to make them feel important, like take her on a tour of the school. When those kids came back, she already had a relationship. It was the first time she met them. But Brooke asked each one at the end of the conversation, honey, why were you under the table? And again, not one of them said, I planned it. I was angry at my teacher. I ended that up 45 minutes earlier. I had a strategy. Each one of them said, because I'm stupid. Same response, four different schools. Same situation of a child screaming from under the table. But when we go over there, you're not going to be at the table in my class. You're not going to. They escalate even further to where we need to bring them out. My daughter, she's a trauma coach for her elementary school, and she was sharing with me the other day that she got called to a class, and a little guy took his shoes off and threw them at the bulletin board. But I mean, it tore the paper, everything. It was scary for the other kids. And so she went, and the little boy didn't want to go with her. So she kind of wrapped her arms around him, not restraining, but wrapped her arms around him, and she said, let's go outside. I don't want to go outside. I got you. You're safe. I don't want to. I got you. You're not in trouble. You're safe. And she says, Dad, my hand was bouncing off his chest. She said, literally. And I just kept talking to him. When she calls her calm room, and she took him down to the calm room, and she just held him and kept saying, you're okay. And then she says, I want you to start breathing with me. I don't want to breathe. She started breathing. And she says, Dad, he just picked up on me breathing, and he started. And she knew the boy and had history. And she says, now I want you to do the drain breathing, because I know that's your favorite. And so he did the drain breathing. And then he just collapsed. And he goes, just want a little house. So what, honey? Just want to live in the blue house. The blue house was where he lived with his mom and dad. Mom was the president. Dad dumped him off at grandma's. There wasn't a whole lot of relationship there. One was mommy. The blue house represented him, his mom. There's always something that's driving that behavior. And if we take the time to go in with positive intent to find out what's driving it, she gave that little boy a chance to go. But later, he came by at recess and said he wanted to marry her. Of second graders. You know, if you stop and think of it, look at the cartoon. I had an 18-year-old student enroll at Lincoln. He had 3 credits. I brought him in. I said, Jeremy, got 3 credits. We're going to have to go with a GED. I know you don't want to be in school until you're age 27. He goes, yeah, I want to do whatever's the quickest. I said, well, the GED will be quicker, but you have to trust us, and you have to know that we're going to walk you through it, and we're going to be right next to you. But you have to take that GED and take it to college, or it's worthless. You know, our military had dropped the GED, technical schools had dropped the GED. So I said, okay. So we got him started. He was showing up. He's the nicest kid. And then he came by my office one day and wanted to talk, and it was during the time he should be doing his working on his GED, and he said, I came in, I wanted to stop and tell you goodbye from dropping out. I said, Jerry, you can't drop out. I promise you, trust us. We will walk you through this. We will get you to that GED. He goes, Sporleder, I haven't had teachers care about me before I like here. I said, okay, you see it, so stay with us. He says, well, the reason I came by is I wanted to say thank you for teachers. And he said, you don't suspend very often. I said, well, we've kind of changed our philosophy on that. I shared a little bit with him trying to become the trauma stuff. He says, you know what? I got suspended for not going to school. He goes, like that was gonna make me want to come to school. But he then shared, the reason I have to go is I'm homeless. And when I come in for the GED, Shelly's great, but I can't concentrate because I don't know where I'm gonna eat tonight, and I don't know where I'm gonna stay. And he said, every day that I've been coming, I just rolling in my head. So these kids that have these issues, for him, for Jeremy, you know, he walked away and I never did get to see him again. But he left an impression on me. But they're dealing with such issues that it blocks their ability to concentrate. So if we looked at you, you probably start your Mondays off pretty good. Tuesdays, Wednesday, we're climbing. So yeah, we're going to have to look at our level of stress because you have an extremely stressful job. And so when we look at our level of tolerance, as our baseline of stress starts, we don't have a whole lot of room where we're going to want to use trauma-informed practices. We're just going to get right to it. So that's where we have to learn the skill of not allowing ourselves to get up there. Because what happens with kids, when they come to school on Monday, they come from these traumatic, toxic environments. Their stress is probably up there midway. Tuesday comes down a little bit. Wednesday's probably their best day. Thursday, it starts climbing. And Friday, they're up there. Why? Going back home. Move again. So we have to be regulated if we're going to help our kids. So catching our trigger. In fact, we can't get past first base if we're not willing to see the importance of being self-regulated. That's the only way we're going to help these kids. And with every student's behavior, you can guarantee it's fear of failure or not feeling safe. That's usually what's behind these explosive behaviors. So if I catch my trigger and I catch it, you need to do the breathing to help you. Breathing's powerful. I didn't know about breathing when we put the model in. I wish I did. I wish I would have been able to teach those techniques to my kids. But the breathing helps bring you to calm. And then if I'm calm, I can look at the behavior as a teachable moment. So it's kind of a framework of catching my trigger. I catch it because I know that if I want to have a positive student, I've got to be regulated. And then I work myself to calm. A calm adult represents safety to a student. Even when they're going off, if we stay calm, it represents safety. And then we're allowed to approach them with positive intent. It's that teachable moment in which I have the opportunity to make that impact on the student. And that's where trust and relationship can begin. You know what? A deeper understanding of ourselves leads to a deeper understanding of our students. I'm telling you that when you do a trauma-informed model and practices, you are transformed. My Lincoln kids didn't transform, or I didn't transform them, they transformed me. And I'll never be able to give express my gratitude to them for what they gave to me. They taught me so many lessons through conversations. Going back to this slide that I showed earlier, it's the brain that's driving the behavior. And then we want to find out what the story is. So this slide here goes with our kids. ACEs, if I look at the ACEs, the 10, I can't put a score together, but I know I got issues. When I saw this graph, it helped me put my ACEs together. A lot of times when people first hear ACEs, I know my colleague, Terry Burrell, the champion of Wawa, she presented and she had a pediatrician run to the front crying and saying, why didn't they teach us this in medical school? I have 8 of those ACEs. And now I'm figuring out why things have happened like they have. That's what happened to me when I saw this graph. Our kids with the healthy brains, same as what I showed you kind of for a teacher for the week, but their baseline stress is down here pretty low. And they have all that room to work, problem solve. They get the cause of the effect. They're motivated. They're on task. They want good grades. But they have so much area to work in. The reason why we're seeing our kids blowing up is because of the baseline of their stress level. And they don't have a lot of room. And boom, they're done. For me, I had an issue with rage. I would go to rage like that, and I could be punching somebody before my head even caught up. And then, because I was a preacher's kid, I had someone shaking me, reminding me that I was a preacher's kid. And I had one that wouldn't quit shaking me until I told her what the golden rule was. I knew there was a golden rule, just couldn't think of which one it was. And she took that as defiance. So, punishment and the harsh words were I'll always remember. She told me, she said, your dad would be ashamed of you. Don't tell you something like that. And my dad, who I worship, even though his brand was spanking, came from old school, but when she told me that, I believed her. Jeez, my dad was really ashamed of me. So that baseline tolerance really helped me, because I used to go to rage, and then I would feel horrible for what I did, and then I would be reminded of how bad it was. So that helped me put things together. So we're going to start the journey, trauma-informed school. And the goal is hope. We want to help kids find hope. I think it's the greatest gift that we can help them with. Now, trauma-informed practices are what's best for every single student. Second grade teacher shared with me that a girl came in her class and she looked like she emotionally, she was just ready to fall apart. And she came from a great family. And so the teacher approached her. She got down on her knee and she said, "Honey, I can tell something's really bothering you. Can I help you?" The little girl just let it out. She started sobbing. And then she finally was able to share that the family had to put their dog down. And she missed her dog. And what made it worse is, "I miss my dad, and he had to travel out of the town." The teacher validated and worked through her feelings. And at the end of the day, that little girl came up to her and said, "Thank you for helping me today." She was able to articulate and see that. But the same day, she had another student that was upset, ready to lose her. She approached her in the same way. "I can tell you look upset. Is there anything I can do?" And it was, "Daddy beat mommy up last night." So the approach is the same. Both kids' voices were heard. Feelings were validated. Obviously, with the one professional, the professionals were brought in, and that was followed through. But the approach is the same. In a trauma-informed school, it comes down on the principal. Principal has to be the leader. And what we just wrote a pivot for it, let us put a book out, and we tried. My goal was to write in steps that a school could look at and say, "Gee, that's a no-brainer, we can do that." Because you can get the trauma informed pretty quickly when you use, because the steps are fairly simplistic. It's the training and getting our staff to understand the difference of what a trauma brain looks like. Our suggestion is that the principal take a leadership team that represents all the staff and takes 1 year to pilot, because there's your momentum. There's your respected teachers practicing and sharing. And you're sharing the difference you're seeing in the office. And everybody knows that the following year is full implementation. Got a principal in Kansas who've never met face to face. If we've walked through this process, and he's in full implementation this year, and he says it's unbelievable. That year of preparing before we went into the full year of implementation. And he'd send me copies of his emails. He would give out information on trauma, and he always shared, "We will be in full implementation this following year. It wasn't a choice. This is the direction we're going because it's right." And he's seen a lot of positive things happening. I showed you this earlier. You got to get away from reacting and telling to asking and responding. And some of the tools that can be put in place, just this bullseye. When I first started, I taught the kids, you know, red, you've lost it. And I teach them that yellow is you're stressed, but you can still manage. Green we didn't talk about too much because when they came in the office, the kid doesn't go from red to green. Classroom teacher can use this. We're in the green zone. I want to stretch your learning today. So there are going to be some new concepts I'm going to teach you. And it's going to be a little uncomfortable, but that's how we stretch our knowledge and our learning. But I don't want to send anybody under the red, because then I'll lose you. So you need to communicate with me if you feel like you're getting close, your frustration level is getting close to the rim. Because that's not my point. I want to make sure I'm there to support you so that you don't find yourself in the red. So it can be used as a classroom tool. Then I started, we put the numbers on it. Then I just started asking kids when they came in from 1 to 10, where are you with your stress? And that last year it was just 8, 9, 8, 9, 8, 9, 8, 9, get a 10, get a 7, 8, 9, 8, 9. Then, if you look where an 8, 9 is, it's you can't function as an 8, 9 in school. You have got to be dealing with some pretty heavy students. That opens the conversation up. You can't handle that kind of a load. We've got to help you lower that load. And that opens. And you're able to then start talking. That's where we made referrals to the health center for counseling. Gave us opportunities. So, for me, that simple tool created really meaningful conversations. And that's where I taught them about triggers. I taught them about when you're in the red, the cortisol flooding your brain. But I use it as a teaching tool. And then what happens is you'll see the kids will come by and say, "Sporleder, I'm about ready to lose it." They start self-regulating because you have the systems in place. Elementary, calm place, safe place in the classroom. If you teach it, the kids will start using it to self-regulate. So if we take this, we break it down on the concept, is that the stress is coming from outside the school or from past experiences. I have one student, when we were at 5.5 ACEs, tell me that their stress was caused by school. Every single one of them, there was something outside that was causing their stress. And they may have just told the teacher that off. But once they were able to process, it was had nothing to do with the teacher. But we have to understand it's not about me. That's why dropping the personal mirror is so important for regulation. For those of you that saw Paper Tigers, Steven, it's kind of hard to follow, but he was flicking the lighter in class. Teacher couldn't get the lighter from him. Sent him down to me. Walks in, held my hand out, said, "Steven, I gotta have your lighter, but I can't have it in school. I'm not getting my lighter. I gotta have your lighter. Just hand it over and get back to class. You're not getting my effing lighter." I said, "Steven," kind of alluded to it, but I opened my drawer of 25, you pick your color or lighter, which one. I said, "Steven, these 25 kids gave me the lighter. Make it simple. Give me your lighter and go back to class. I said you're not getting my effing lighter." And then Steven saw a choice. And that's when I gave him my finger about that far from my face and told him to do horrible things to myself. As he walked out, my office had a big window right in the middle of the office. He turns, flips me off again, tells me the same horrible stuff. And I get up and I walk. I know he's heading off campus, but I gave him his space. But bless his heart, he got to the gate, turned around, and gave it to me again. Well, in my traditional role, I'm telling you, I had an assistant principal once tell me, if I kick you under the table, you've said it enough. Nobody's gonna talk to me like that. But when you're able to drop your mirror, it gives you freedom to then find out, what the heck does that? And so when I got back to the office, my secretary was in there, or my receptionist, Rosa, and she goes, oh my God. I said, what's wrong, Rosa, are you jealous? She said, what are you? She got up, she got annoyed with me. Jealous, what do you mean? I said, I can see it in your face, you're jealous. What are you talking about? That was horrible. I said, Rosa, when has a person told you that you're number one 3 times and that's short of a stick? Because when you drop your mirror, we were able to come back. I wasn't all bent out of shape. I knew there was something was going on. And a teacher came by and came in my office and said, did you hear about Steve? I said, well, I didn't work with him, or didn't work with him. And she says, Stephen's dad would drop him off at his mom's every morning, and then he would walk to school, and his dad drops him off, and the house is vacant, nothing in it. And she's got mentally ill. Stephen knows that. He's freaking out. Where did his mom go? Where is she? Is she safe? Is she okay? And so when I called Stephen's dad, and Stephen's dad and I were like this, because Stephen had me in my traditional mold before I went trauma. And when I told the dad what had happened, I could just hear, I just feel the dad, I'm going to fight this one. So I told the dad I wasn't in school tomorrow. Dad brought him back. And I was able to talk to Stephen about how sorry I felt about his mom. And how horrible that must have been for him to see that she's gone and not know where she's at. And then I said, Stephen, we tell you we love you guys unconditionally. I want you to know that what you said to me yesterday is the past. We're going to keep discipline in school. That's the day. I mean, Stephen gave me a run for my money. But with a trauma approach, that was the day that he and I began to build a relationship. He went on to Shelley, I just lost mine yesterday and I can come back. He worked his tail end off. And he knew he was loved and forgiven. So we've got to drop the mirror. That's kind of catching our trigger. There's not too many times that we can't allow a student a place to sit and de-escalate. We don't have to always handle the situation right then. I used to handle it. I didn't want to discipline. I didn't like referrals sitting. And I picked them up. I'd go through my clockwork. So I was dealing with escalated kids. When you tell a student, let's process this, I'm not going to have to process it. Sorry, it's secondary. I guess a little bit stupid too. Then, okay, I see it. Your brain's not in place to be able to problem solve. It would be disrespectful if I tried to force you into problem solving now. I need to be respectful of how you're feeling, so I'm going to give you time to calm down. I don't care. I don't have to calm down. 10 minutes, I'd be able to bring it back in, and we were able to process. I did have one time that I had 3 boys come in and said they weren't going to have to calm down, and they didn't have to calm down. I didn't know what to do. They were on the ceiling. I was lucky there was a few, 10 minutes left of school, so I just said, hey guys, head on out the door, head for home, but in the morning, we're going to come back and work through this. We're not effing coming back. So the next morning, I'm supervising down at the lunchroom, and here they come. Look like the Three Stooges. Dip bopping and everything. And one of them, I mean, they're all walking like this to go by me. And they stop, and one pats me on the back. Says, hey, Sporleder, you don't have to call us in this morning. We were really out of line. We really screwed up yesterday. We already went down and talked to Jordan, and we're going to do our discipline with him after school. So, this stuff works. Because of relationship. They knew they blew it with the teacher that they loved. And they went in and made it right. So we have to have those quiet places. I use my in-school suspension room. I use it for everything. Timeouts, discipline consequences. Kid had a horrible night, and we heard that they had SWAT might have raided their house. Then we would call them in and say, you need some sleep. Go on, see Shelly. We had a couch up there. And get some sleep. I've had people say, well, how long was the line of kids wanting to avoid class? There wasn't a line. Because when you're in a relationship and you have a caring adult, a trusting adult, they don't want to let you down. They appreciate the fact that you are allowing them to go sleep. I didn't have one kid that went up to sleep that I didn't see back in the hallway within an hour and a half. And I would stop them and say, you got to go back up and get sleep. You had a horrible night. No, I'm okay. Plus, I want to go to classes. They don't take advantage. Elementary, so that, you know, the calm. Now I need to know where their stress level was, and I can go from there. The kids respond. Let's face it. When a teacher really loses it, or one of us administrators really loses it, we're not thinking about teaching. We're kind of thinking about the punishment part. If I've really been offended, I want 5 pounds of flesh out of that little sucker. And then it becomes about me and not about the student. So we want to use consequences as much as possible to keep kids in school, to foster that trust and safety. When we keep putting them out of school, we keep putting them back into the environment that's causing their pain, their wounds, and it's not changing their behaviors. So in developing a trauma-informed approach, like I was sharing, I think the administrator needs that leadership team. It makes it more powerful. And you pull people from all areas. My head cook had a wonderful relationship with our kids. No kid went hungry. Do you have any of these policies that kids get one helping of the main meal, but they come back for seconds for celery and salad? We did. And then supposed to throw everything else away. So I called up the superintendent and I said, I just want you to know I'm breaking district policy. If I got too many hungry kids, I'm not throwing food away. He says, okay. But we literally could take a nuns sleep in the hallway. Kid, thank you for not for tonight. Cooks are, to me, they're worth their weight in gold. However, we have to look at our policies, because I was in a situation where a little guy had lost it, and he was in the office, and he was like this, and he wouldn't talk to anybody, he was angry, he was upset. And finally, when the principal was able to kind of get him down, de-escalate him, and started to ask him about why he blew up in the lunchroom, he growls, we're poor! He's doing this. And finally, you realize the school stamps their hands when they don't have money for their lunch. So, you stamp a hand, and we look at them and say, just like the library deal. You didn't bring your, I told you, Harold was stamped yesterday, and your parent was supposed to send money today. You got mom using meth at home? You got these toxic environments, and we're expecting 5 and 6 year olds to bring that money in or get your hands stamped. My daughter was teaching at the time, and she, one of her kids just lost it. She checked with them, what's wrong? I had to go stand in the cheese line. Believe me, I didn't have my lunch account up when they said I had to stand in the cheese sandwich line. So, we went to the school district and said, you gotta knock this stamp stuff off. And my God. So they stopped that. And they replace it with, you can't go stand in the cheese sandwich line. So here I am. I'm poor if I'm stamped, and I'm poor because I'm standing in that lunch line. I went to the 4 schools that we were serving and I asked them for their balance of kids who owe for lunches. And I paid them off. And I said, I don't want any kids standing in line for a cheese sandwich. I'll be back. And I'm not. 2 secretaries were upset with me. Jim, you're taking their accountability and responsibility off of them. Upset that I was paying the bill. So we have to look at our policies sometimes and see what kind of impact it has on our kids who struggle. You can 75% to 80%. I think with your leadership team, you're gonna have a whole lot more momentum. But you gotta have that 75-80, otherwise you're gonna have sabotage. And I have some staff who tried to sabotage. Talk about that in a few minutes. And to understand it's a journey and not a foot race. It's a focused journey. And what happens is you start to see the successes of these strategies and it motivates you to learn more. Just wrap around support better because you bond with these kids. And the teachers, that's where a lot of information comes out. Because kids have built that relationship with their teacher and they'll share for homeless. So that information gets passed forward so that we can support them. Teachers are huge. Paraeducators are huge. But we gotta work as a team. I think paraeducators are one of the best things we have going, but we don't pay them. That's horrible. But if we're working as a team, we're looking for kids that are beginning to escalate. and we intervene before they go. Because when I hit the lows, the question is, what was happening before he blew? And I've been in schools where they've asked me to observe kids who have been disrupting classes. And when you go in, I went into this one class, I couldn't believe it. It was a first grade class. I'm a big guy. So I knew I had to try to build some kind of rapport with the kids. So I hit the knees like I do at home with my wife. I'm female dominated, I'm not going to lie. So I'm getting at eye level, I'm trying to build rapport, I'm watching across the room at the two kids that I'm supposed to be observing. 5 feet away is a parent educator like this. And one little guy is finally turned around in the seat facing the wrong way. And you can see that his disruption was rising. This. It's like I tried to scoop as much as so I finally get over to the little guy that's turned around in his seat and started talking to him. Got some questions about himself. We built a little bit of a rapport. And I just said, he's first grader. I said, are you having a hard time with this second grade work? He goes, that's not second grade work. Oh, it looks like second grade work to me. I can do it. You can do this? Turns around. But I sat with him until he was almost done. The parent, like this. The other child at the end of the table, I'm thinking, I got it, it's a little girl, so I'm trying to, okay, I want to build rapport. And I'm walking towards her, and she looks up at me, and she says, can you help me? I don't understand this. First grade. I had a hard time with this item myself. I thought it took me a long time to figure it out. But when I sat down with her, and she got it, and she got confidence, I was able to get up and move. And as I was leaving the classroom, I got this tug on my shirt, and that's the little guy. Let him show me that he finishes the cycle. So if we work as a team and if we're intervening when we see the escalation starting, a lot of times if the class is getting a little bit riled up, it's just simply, hey, I think it's a good time for us to take some deep, you know, they've got all kinds of teaching, breathing techniques, and do our brain breathing. Why don't we do that? And teachers will say, after that, the calm will come back down. I think, as the principal, as the leader, we have to make sure that our main office is customer friendly. What would I see if I came into your school? Our high school is one of the top high schools in the state. Graduation rates, assessment scores. They would read a student's file that was enrolling and see, they're not going to help us on our assessments. So they would walk up to the counter and tell the parent, your student is a Y student. You need to go to Lincoln. Or your student wouldn't work here. You need to go over to Lincoln. He's a Lincoln student. She's a Lincoln student. That demeaning culture, because we want to keep our top position, but that demeaning culture, you can imagine what we got when they got to our school. We were ready for a fight with the way that they had been treated. body language. Our office should represent who we are. And when a parent comes in, or a visitor comes in, a student comes in, they should be welcome. Even if they're upset, we're going to take care of you. I know you're upset, but we're going to take care of you. And just validating them. Because struggling parents, we don't say we're going to take care of you. We want to get them out of there. So in our main office, we've got to set that culture of caring. Sometimes we isolate the parent. Many of these parents are so uncomfortable coming into our schools. We need to have a place that they're comfortable. And we need to greet them. And let them know, come in here, make yourself comfortable. Registration. I'm so not now busy here, filling out. We will share with our parents. This is our enrollment packet. It's kind of difficult to fill out, so we're going to check with you to see how you're doing so we can help you. So that we would take the fear down and that many of those parents have a difficult time filling those forms out. That they knew we were going to check on them. We already told them that they would have difficulty. So it made it safe to come back. Can I get you a cup of coffee, water while you're here? Making them feel comfortable. It sounds a little, but I wouldn't let parents be brought back to my office. I would go out and meet them where they were at. Greet them. If they were upset, I would say we're going to work on it. We're going to get to the bottom of this. And then I'd start talking to their little ones. Because they always bring the whole family, right? So then I'd talk to the little ones. And then I'd tell the student, we're going to take care of you, and you're going to like it. And then I would walk them back, and I would let them come into my office. I'd say, come in, make yourself comfortable. And I would go in and sit down until they chose where they wanted to sit. And when I sat down, I said, come. Now, if they're still mad, by that time, usually after we had gone through that process, they were coming down. But how can I help you with your issue today? How can I support you? Those parents aren't used to that kind of response. But I think the office can be that calm. It's the calm. It represents safety and it values those who come in. If you put systems in place and you have options, then when you're dealing with discipline, you've got your in-school suspension room. I don't know why my kid's lunch detention was like to cut off their right arm. But if there's illegal infractions, you got to deal with them. They're illegal. Our SRO has such a good rapport with our kids, and you should never be using your SRO to do school discipline. And teachers should never be walked up to an SRO and say, that student cussed at me, I want him arrested. I had that when we first got our SRO. Or, John's walking off campus. Get the SRO and arrest him. It's like, learn the law. But we got to hold students accountable. These kids need to know the boundaries. We owe it to them. Clear boundaries. And if we teach them the boundaries, that creates predictability and safety. And it's how we frame our questions to them and how we deliver the consequences that makes the difference. So trauma-informed isn't loading stuff on your plate, it's reframing. It's having systems in place so that kids can work those to help them on regulation. So these were some of the options that we had, not a whole lot. On the illegal piece, if a student was very cooperative, we would do the citation and we wouldn't handcuff them and take them to jail. So they still had to deal with the citation, they still had to deal with the district attorney and school discipline. We would hug kids before, sometimes when we had to send them in, we'd hug them before they left. They'd be crying, "I'm so sorry." Everybody makes mistakes. But we wouldn't cuff them in the office. I used to say, cuff them in the office and I want everybody to see it. So the other kids don't know, we don't put up with this stuff. We told our kids, "We're not going to handcuff you in the office. Matt's going to walk you out to the car when the kids are in class. But when he gets to the car, he has to handcuff you." We would tell them exactly what was going to happen. And then there's times you got to cuff him. In a trauma-informed environment, you have high adult visibility. Before school is an incredible time if you have people spread out enough that you greet kids and you read kids. It's very easy. "Good morning, John," or high five. Everybody was bud because I'm so bad at names. You know, fist bump, whatever. And I'd say good morning and no hand and "Let's get it out of here." Yeah, no. So when school started, I'd call that student down and just say, "I noticed this morning when you came to school, you looked like you were really upset. Is there anything we can do for you?" "I'm fine." "It's okay. Just checking on you." Or sometimes they would bring out their dealing with an issue and we'd work through it. I think greeting kids is huge. And as administrators, what a great time to interact with kids. I don't think any kid, I don't care what size school, I don't think any student should be able to isolate and not be acknowledged. And they're not hard to find. You know? They're tucked in the corner way over there. And when you go up to these kids, they're not going to acknowledge it. "It's good to have you here today." They're not going to say, "Well, thank you." But they need to be acknowledged that you appreciate them being here. And when you do that, 6 weeks down the line, you wish they would isolate a little bit because of that relationship and that connectedness. Sure, John, I'm with you. Correct student behavior. When you have to correct the behavior that needs to be corrected now, take the audience away. Pull kids over. "Why are you pulling me over?" "Because I respect you, and I do not want this to be a big thing in front of everybody else. But I walked by you and I said, 'Language, please.' And I took 2 steps and I heard the F-bomb the second time. Does this need to be an issue that we have to take further, or is this an issue that you can take care of that we don't have to go to the office on? I can take care of it. Thank you." But you do it not like, "Danny, go over there and sit at the table." Because when you call a kid out in front of his peers, game is on, they're not going to lose. They lose in the discipline, but they're not going to lose in front of their peers. Knowledge kids doing it right. Keep connected to your struggling kids. Now, you can't do that as one person. That's why you as a school at your focus is connected. And the struggling kids, they're the same way as the isolated. What are you talking to me for? Just want you to know I'm glad to have you here today. Well, I hate this school.
It's okay.
But I'm happy to have you. Takes time with some of these kids because the trust level is so far out. Acknowledging kids and they're doing it right, this is very important to gain kids. I used to hang on their ear. And so if our cameras picked up two kids going down the hallway and there might have been a hard stare, you can kind of tell. Call them in. And I would thank them. I would tell them that I was watching the cameras and I noticed that there seemed to be some friction. And I want to thank you that you did not cause any of the friction and that you're respecting our expectations that the colors stay out on the curb and they don't come in the building. Because if they come in the building, that's a disrespect to me. I use their language. But when you leave them on the curb, you're going to be respected. It's always kind of. They're good. Even if the conflict could have happened, it's calm. Because then you say, I am so glad I didn't have to get mad on it and make it a legal issue and put this police hat on. Now, there's empathy, but there's a message there. So glad it didn't happen because Matt would have put his police hat on. Had two kids leave campus for lunch, two gang members opposite. They go two blocks down and get in a fist fight in an alley. Of course, a neighbor calls us. Matt gets down there, brings them back to school. I haven't even talked to him yet. They're in two separate offices. And they want to talk to Sporleder. I want to talk to Sporleder. So when I go in to the one, I said, you know, colors stay on the curb. Sporleder, that's why we left campus. I got to the other one. That's why we left campus. So, but still, I think it's a comes on the curve makes sense. You come in, you do learning. Just that proactive. This is where it takes a lot of energy and time, but it pays off big. And that is if you hear of drama or something that's going to happen, get involved earlier so you can do interventions. Because when you get involved early, you keep the conflict from happening, and you also send the message, I understand there's some real drama here. We see what's on Facebook. It's in writing. Something happens, Matt puts his police hat on. We don't want that. Still setting the expectations, high expectations, but we're saying, nope, don't follow through on the conflict. But because Matt will have his police hat on. I'm running out of time, so I already told him pretty much of that in school suspension room. We used it for, we actually did our GED in there. And there were times kids couldn't regulate, they would come down and be referred to me. You have to have the right person in this position. If you're punitive, military type, it's not going to work. It'll blow up on you. You've got to have a person that can make caring relationships, but also hold the line of expectation. RSRO, this is Kevin, he was promoted to sergeant. He wrote one of those beautiful letters to the staff, but basically he shared, "I'm going back through the streets a different person with a new perspective after seeing the trauma-informed model." And he does trainings for law enforcement on trauma-informed strategies. Paper at 1:15. I'll just go real fast because I don't want to leave any longer. When you got staff pushing back, my strategy was I told them I would meet them on common ground. I said, what we're doing is research based. I'm not going to go where you're at. I can't go where you're at because the research says that's fine. But I am willing to move on common ground. You just bring your research. So every time they came up to complain, I'd say, oh, bring your research. And they quit coming. There's no research to back that up. And then you got to have those tough conversations, because if I'm not willing to be change my approach, and I make it about me, then I'm hurting kids. And those are tough discussions. They're not easy, but they need to be had. Maybe this isn't the place for you. And make it, you know, we're a different approach. Maybe your style would fit better in a different school. If that, do you feel that? Well, I can help you with that. Already told you about the games. Last thing is just that the more you work with your community and bring them into your school, it's such a powerful model. Our faith-based community did all the remodeling for the health center, community college. We had always put us on the scholarship list, always worked with us. Juvenile justice, we had a great relationship with our POs. We didn't have to make the POs, we did say, do not come and arrest your kid at school. Unless it was a health and safety issue. And some kids are out running the streets and they're drunk, and we gotta get them locked up for safety. But don't just come because you don't want to go to the house and find them. Our judges have gone through trauma informed. Children's Home Society works with our parents who've had their kids taken away from them. They use trauma informed strategies of 100 families. Having kids taken away, it's only been one family that's lost their kids again. And of course, the after-school programs are incredible. The CPS, you heard Brooke, if you watch Paper Tiger, Brooke could call now. Brooke called, they are on the phone there. But she could make things happen. And if there was concern for safety of the kids, she could talk that through. So having those partners, community partners, we couldn't have made it without them. And I'll end with this. This young man, that's the Himalayas. And I love him like a son. He's, when it comes to Walla Walla, and I take him out for breakfast or lunch, it's, I don't want the conversation to end, and when I hug him, I don't want to let go. His life experience is unbelievable. But he's walked the Pacific Trail. He's on a 500-mile bicycle ride in Vietnam. And here he's walking the path in the Himalayas. But he told me, he said, before coming to Lincoln, I was going to take my life. And I hadn't heard that before. This was the last time he and I met, and I said, Ethan, you never told me that. He goes, yeah, I got it. He goes, I have a plan. And I thought, well, new school, I'll try it. If it works, fine. If it doesn't, I was going to take myself out. And I said, Steve, or Ethan, what was it? He said, I came the Lincoln and you, meaning staff. And this kid, just amazing. And that's the impact all of you have on your kids and the opportunities that you have.